Mattel, the creators of Barbie, hated Aqua's Barbie Girl. They found it offensive and damaging to their brand, and they were kind of right. The song was about plastic surgeries and the beauty standards that lead people to feel they need to change their bodies, standards which, of course, Barbie heavily reflected. But in 2009, Mattel made an attempt to salvage the song by covering it with new, inoffensive lyrics. It wasn't meant to be frightening regardless of the effect, but the point was to take the controversial song and make it into something inoffensive for their brand, make it fit their marketing of Barbie. Now with the release of the new Barbie film, the song has been sampled by Nicki Minaj and Ice Spice. Any of Aqua's original social commentary has long been neutralized by Mattel. When you've got the cash, it's not so difficult to subsume criticism of your own company. You can see it in other media such as Black Mirror satirizing streaming services and their exploitation of workers. This satire, of course, being available only on the very company they seek to satirize. If you hate Netflix, subscribe to Netflix for the best anti-Netflix content. So when Margot Robbie met with Mattel's CEO to discuss developing a Barbie movie, she was very blunt about the fact that a lot of people hate Barbie. She said that the conversation around Barbie's controversies is gonna happen either way, so better to be involved in that conversation. And we all know the criticisms, right? Barbie isn't feminist enough, she's too skinny, she's bad for self-esteem, etc., etc. Well, that's where Greta Gerwig comes in, famed director of Lady Bird and Little Women. Gerwig had managed to pull off a careful balance with Little Women, giving it a feminist twist, commenting on the expectations for women to have a romantic ending, while also just going ahead and giving us the romantic ending anyway. Women truly can have it all. As long as they're incredibly beautiful, of course. Gerwig had her cake and ate it too, shattering the glass fourth wall for a self-aware nod to critics of Little Women's ending. Could she do the same for Barbie, bringing the franchise into the 21st century with careful nods to the sexism of the past, while also appeasing the pop culture feminist standards of the present? Gerwig's Barbie stars Will Ferrell as a wacky, lovable villain, the CEO of Mattel, a man in charge of Barbie trying to capture her and put her in a box. Oh no! This meta-commentary positions the Barbie character as a victim of Mattel's more problematic choices, as well as a victim of the hatred and vitriol she receives from the women and girls of the world to whom it is her life's goal to bring happiness. It's an interesting way of kind of anthropomorphizing the brand. You're not criticizing Mattel when you talk shit about Barbie. You're being mean to poor little Barbie herself. Poor Barbie, she never did anything wrong. Time magazine kind of did the same thing back in 2016 when the new curvy Barbie doll was released. Now can we stop talking about my body? As if Barbie herself had been a victim of some sort of body shaming. Her thinness wasn't a piece of plastic embodying society expectations of what women's bodies should look like. Rather, she was just an innocent skinny woman whose body was constantly under scrutiny by the public. Aren't you tired of watching women like Barbie twisting themselves into knots just to be liked? As the film states, if all these misogynist standards for women are even put on a doll just representing women, then is there hope for any of us? If you hate Barbie, it's clearly just because you hate women. If you hate Barbie, then maybe you are the real misogynist. That'll be $10.99, please. The Barbie film opens with the send-up of 2001 A Space Odyssey, where little girls smash their baby dolls with the arrival of the magnificent Barbie, a symbol of modernity, of progress. The age of the baby doll was over. Barbie was the way of the future. And that's fairly true to life, besides the proportions and the smashing. Before Barbie, girls were expected to play pretty exclusively with baby dolls, training from an early age for their role as mother, as caregiver. But Barbie changed things. She was a new toy for the modern girl, a fashion model embodying all of the aspirational qualities of the modern young woman of the late 50s and early 60s. Barbie wasn't a mum, she was a young woman with a job, and with that job came money to spend. Her work as a fashion model tied in with your play of her. You bought the doll, which was cheap enough, and then you had to buy all the different clothing sets for Barbie to model. Your shopping was a part of the Barbie play. Repeatedly purchasing more Barbie products was basically a necessity. Shopping was built into the product. Genius, really. You kept those little kids buying and buying all for this one doll. And that is what made Barbie the modern woman, that she was a shopper. A consumer. She reflected the developing teen culture of the 1950s, one with its own distinct language, music, and clothing. After all, Barbie was only 19 years old. The youth of the day had money and they were ready to spend it. What made Barbie the young woman of the modern world wasn't some noble feminist goal, it was her relationship to consumption. Indulgent spending was the aspiration of the day, and Barbie helped teach girls to associate adulthood with carefree consumption.
I think I'd like, I'll
times have moved on, yet again, and the role of the middle-class woman has evolved, and so has Barbie's. Obviously, Barbie's brand is no longer just about being a young woman with money to spend. She's no longer just a fashion model, even. Barbie can be anything. A doctor, an astronaut, a yoga instructor. That's the feminism of today, a woman who can have it all. Now you can help your little girl develop her interest in STEM with the STEM Barbie doll. But you don't want to just influence your kid with only one job, do you? Remember, girls can do anything. Lots and lots and lots of anything. Today's Barbie is so much more than just a shopper. But if you want to really explore her big wide world of female empowerment, you gotta spend a few bucks. You purchase Barbie's identity. She is what she owns.
I've got the clothes from every career I've ever had.
We may not associate Barbie with fashion model anymore, but she is a YouTuber, and she's on Instagram. If anything, Barbie is an influencer now. Basically the 2023 equivalent of the 1959 fashion model. And in a way, she's always been an influencer, hasn't she? That's her main job.
If you were a fashion model like Barbie, you'd lead a different life every day of the week.
But at least she's always been a responsible influencer. A feminist one, even. As their website states, Barbie went to the moon and back in 1965, 4 years before real-world men did.
You went to the moon?
You haven't?
In the 80s, Barbie proved that girls can do anything.
And we girls can dream anything. Right, Barbie? Right, Barbie?
And yes, there have been some controversies over the years with regards to how she affects girls' body image, but even that has changed now. In 2016, Mattel released 3 new body types, finally bringing some body diversity to the brand. And now, with their Inspiring Women doll series, you can buy Barbies of famous historical women such as Rosa Parks, Maya Angelou, Helen Keller, and of course, a most barbalicious Frida Kahlo. Barbie helps to show girls that they can have jobs, just like men. The feminism is real. Except Mattel actually seems pretty averse to the word feminism. They recently went so far as to say that the new film is not a feminist movie. Huh. Okay. That casts a slightly different light on things. I guess Barbie went galactic 4 years before men did, but the first woman had actually already been to space a few years before the Barbie astronaut costume was released. Funny how Mattel never mentions that. They just heavily imply that she beat men to the moon, even though going to the moon wasn't part of the original astronaut costume marketing. And yeah, Barbie did release new body types, but only after their profit crashed in 2015. Mattel needed to rebrand because the decades of body image criticism caught up with them, and everyone saw Barbie as irrelevant and socially irresponsible. The new body types were major press fodder, and who doesn't love some free advertising through media reports? But if you actually look at the bodies, we've got classic skinny, short skinny, tall skinny, and slim thick, who is actually still really skinny compared to real women's bodies. She's just rocking that 2010s Kim Kardashian booty. Is this body diversity? Barbie's body has been controversial since the beginning. In 1959, mums weren't comfortable with the idea of getting their daughters a doll with boobs. And this chick came with very skimpy outfits early on, including the nighty negligee set. Barbie's design itself was actually snatched from a sexy German doll made for men, Build Lily. Ruth Handler of Mattel, who was credited with creating Barbie, found Lily while on vacation, and Mattel copied the doll, who looks almost exactly the same as the original Barbie. Jack Ryan, the designer who engineered Barbie, wanted her to be the perfect woman.
They copied her exactly like the German one. So she had a little waist and great big pointy tip.
So no wonder the doll made parents uncomfortable. To bypass parents' anxieties about this very provocative toy, Mattel started selling her as a doll to teach self-presentation skills to little girls. Barbie was good for girls, actually, and this marketing technique is still around today. Girls can do anything. We love the idea that Barbie is actually a tool to help girls become better women. After all, who encourages more girls to run for president? Shirley Chisholm? Kamala Harris? Or presidential candidate Barbie? Would any girls really learn to paint if they didn't have a yassified Frida Kahlo Barbie? Won't little girls be more comfortable with their bodies now that they have curvy Barbie? Well, no, actually, studies have found that little girls really don't like curvy Barbie, even calling her fat. Hello, I'm a fat person, fat, 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 said one little girl playing, while others laughed. And what I see on store shelves, to be honest, is overwhelmingly classic Barbie. And of the Barbies made as film merch, only the skinny actors were adapted to Barbies, possibly because a bigger body shape just doesn't even exist. But why, if Mattel is so eager to sell Barbie as feminist, do they have this aversion to the word? If you're going to use feminist movements to sell your product, it seems weird to avoid the word feminist, right? I mean, they're perfectly comfortable putting girl power on Barbie's t-shirts, and girl power is surely feminism in its purest, most undiluted form, right? I mean, the Spice Girls basically invented feminism, freeing all women from the shackles of patriarchy. Except there was actually a precursor to girl power, the Riot Girl punk rock movement. Riot Girls owned their record labels and created a non-hierarchical DIY culture. They celebrated girls and sang about controversial issues such as gendered violence, reproductive justice, body image, and sexuality. They brought feminist messages from academia into the lives of young women. Riot Girl started to fall apart when the scene started receiving more media attention, which painted it as a fashion craze rather than a feminist movement. It was Riot Girl who came up with the notion of girl power, but the mainstream music industry realized there could be a lot of money in this sort of branding. It was the Spice Girls who really made girl power a worldwide phenomenon, but in the process, the idea was completely watered down so that it could appeal to the broadest possible audience for the most profit. Where Riot Girl was able to be openly political because it wasn't profit-driven, the Spice Girls, on the other hand, lost a lot of the subversive power of Riot Girl. They were created and financed by a group of men who strategically engineered the group to fit a gap in the market. Their work wasn't rooted in feminism, it was looking to make a fashion craze. They didn't critique the status quo, they didn't talk about systemic change, they relied on traditional notions of beauty, and the media loved them because they generated massive amounts of attention and profit. The DIY culture of Riot Girl feminism was turned into an endless stream of girl power merchandise for sale. So there's this commodification. We take a movement with a more radical message, something which demands systemic change in our society, and we flatten it into an aesthetic, a style mass-manufactured and packaged and placed on the shelves for purchase. It's a plastic feminism. The movement becomes mainstream, but it's a neutered version of it, a powerless version. It's not a movement, it's a t-shirt. Barbie in a girl power t-shirt is a far cry from girl power's Riot Girl roots. This Barbie doesn't care about reproductive justice. Frida Kahlo's image and life have been used in a similar way. In 2018, Barbie herself made a vlog about Frida Kahlo because it was Barbie's birthday and this was her gift to her subscribers.
My birthday present to you is to share the story of Frida Kahlo.
Wow, that's so nice of her to educate girls about Frida. Totally by coincidence, unmentioned by Barbie, Mattel released their Frida Kahlo Barbie doll at the same time. Now girls can feel inspired by this totally affordable Frida doll. Frida herself was actually a communist and an anti-capitalist and would have absolutely hated the doll. She deliberately defied gender roles, classical beauty ideals, and the objectification of women, both in her life and her work. She portrayed women's bodies as blemished, imperfect, real, and de-eroticized, a polar opposite to everything Barbie represents. Her family members went on to protest the doll. Frida's great-niece said, "It should have been a much more Mexican doll with darker skin, a unibrow, not so thin, because Frida was not that thin." But the real Kahlo isn't what's important. It's the image that Kahlo brings to the Barbie brand and to Mattel. She has come to be associated in popular culture with feminism on some vague level, and that's enough for Mattel to want to use her image for their brand, to help parents see that, like Barbie with her vlog, they just care about empowering young girls. When Disney decided it was time to take their classic cartoon about a young woman who is imprisoned by a cruel and violent man until she learns to love him, and update it with a more progressive live-action remake, they cast Emma Watson in the leading role. Watson had been in the public eye recently for her UN speech on feminism, asking men to be more involved in ending sexism. This new image of Emma Watson as the inoffensive voice of feminist youth made her an ideal candidate for the role of Belle. Disney has long suffered from feminist critiques of their films, Beauty and the Beast not the least of them. After all, earlier versions of the fairy tale were about arranged marriage, preparing girls for the self-sacrifice that comes with it. Perhaps your husband will be super friggin' gross, but you can learn to love him if you try. Could Watson's image give Beauty and the Beast a feminist vibe for the 21st century? Well, I'll tell you something, she stepped up to the plate with some big changes in mind. Yes, it's still a film about a cruel, abusive man who imprisons her and then tries to get her to fall in love with him, but it's important to note that Emma Watson was involved in making sure Belle wore more sensible shoes while he did it. She also made sure that Belle wasn't carrying a basket around town, but rather had pockets to carry things in. Her Belle is also an inventor, inventing a washing machine early in the film, though she never uses that skill again at any point. I know, this sounds like a lot, and we really have to give Disney some credit here. Emma Watson was like, "Since I'm playing a farmer girl, can I not wear ballet shoes?" And Disney was like, "This is it. The feminist revolution." I do think Emma Watson's feminism is sincere, but it has ended up being funneled back into the Hollywood machine and used for Disney's progressive rebrand. Her role in the film giving a veneer of feminist glamour to a soulless remake written, directed, and produced by men. Watson has also starred in Greta Gerwig's Little Women, and Gerwig too has come to be associated with feminism in film, and her involvement with the Barbie film immediately informed public opinion before it had even premiered. Feminism has become Gerwig's brand, and social changes in fashion. In fact, Gerwig seems to be building her career on remaking big franchises with a progressive coat of paint. It was recently revealed that Netflix has hired her to write and direct new Narnia films. So, of course, Barbie was always going to be an immediate feminist classic. Barbie isn't just skinny and conventionally attractive anymore. She comes in all shapes and sizes, ranging from skinny to slim. There are even two curvier Barbies with a whole five lines between them. You may remember Barbie as the whitest woman on the planet, but that's not true anymore. Except for the lead Barbie, played by Margot Robbie, who is the main character and gets the vast majority of the screen time. And don't worry, the movie is super self-aware about the problematic history of Barbie. A girl named Sasha, who has become disillusioned with Barbie, lists off everything she hates about the doll, from body image problems to just generally calling her a fascist, as any average Gen Zer would do. The way in which the film highlights feminist issues is what makes it so appealing to a modern audience. Because the fact is, we love to feel like we can shop our way through social change, that our purchases will make a difference. And Mattel knows it. Worried about the horrifying effects of Barbie's plastic bodies on the environment? Well, don't panic. Mattel has produced special environmental activist Barbies, which are partially made from recycled plastics, which means, since they've already been partially recycled once, that they can never ever be recycled again and will exist forever. These Barbies hate plastic, but are made of plastic. They hate their very existence. That's why they scream. Oh well, that seems like a losing battle. Perhaps instead we could buy our way out of sexism. Girls aren't making it in STEM careers? Well, Barbie is here to support and empower them with their Barbie STEM dolls. Of course, in the real world, the reason why there are so few women in STEM is not because they haven't considered whether Barbie could work in STEM, it's because they face misogyny at every turn. From the gendered expectations of teachers to hostile and abusive work environments, they have fewer opportunities and are paid less. But maybe, if little girls could only buy a STEM Barbie, then they would finally see that girls can do anything. If you believe in yourself, no amount of misogyny or violence can stand in your way. Am I right, ladies? To be fair, Mattel does offer school workshops and mentorship conferences to support girls in their ambitions, investing as much as 0.1% of their profit into supporting girls. Wow, they really do care. Yeah, no, it's just a load of faux feminist marketing. It's meant to give you that feeling that you've made a small difference in the world by making your purchase, that you've done a shop for social change. And, sorry, Greta Gerwig, the film really isn't any better than that. For instance, in one scene, Margot Robbie's Barbie says she feels ugly, and the scene pauses so that the narrator can make a comment about how Margot Robbie is too pretty to say that. And the point is for the movie to be like, body image. Am I right, ladies? Now you can't say in your reviews and your tweets that the film didn't bring up body image problems. It really did. The feminist revolution started with Emma Watson's shoes, and now here we are. Incredible. The film really slows itself down trying to anticipate all of your potential criticism. It's like they scrolled through Twitter and found every half-baked complaint about Barbie and just shoved a line in the film to just try to preemptively counteract it. And it gets pretty tiresome. But that's because this isn't really a film about feminism. It's a mainstream film made for the widest possible audience, trying to reach everyone at the same time without saying anything of any real substance. Flattened, plastic-wrapped feminism. Because while the film can call out problems like Barbie and body image, a popular topic which probably everyone has had at least one conversation about, there are other problems they can never confront. A few years ago, China Labor Watch sent undercover investigators into Mattel's factories in China where they make their toys, including Barbies, and they found that life for the women who make Barbie isn't so great. For instance, they found that most workers were women and most higher-ups were men. Female workers reported regular verbal abuse and humiliation by line managers. Workers' dormitories housed up to 10 people per room and were infested by fleas, mosquitoes, and other bugs. There was no hot water in the showers, the cold water was dirty, and the toilets had no doors. The food in the cafeterias was served on dirty dishes, and workers found hair and cockroaches in their meals. The pay was so low that workers had to work illegal amounts of overtime if they wanted to make a living wage. They described production targets as inhumane, and they were not provided with safety equipment even when working with dangerous materials. Female workers reported a climate of frequent and trivialized sexual harassment. When Mattel was made aware of the harassment and discrimination in their factories, They did not announce any measures to stamp it out. The latest undercover report about Mattel's factories concludes, at the very least, women who produce Barbie dolls should be able to work without fear of humiliation or harassment. Barbie makes a mockery of women's rights. So weird they didn't mention any of this in the Barbie film, huh? There's this really emotional scene in the film, a feminist speech about the cognitive dissonance of being a woman under patriarchy. Gloria talks about how you need to have money, but you can't ask for money, about how you have to put up with men's bad behavior and stay in line. And she's right, according to these reports. Mattel apparently subjects the workers who make Barbie to this kind of abuse exactly. But then the film shows Mattel bosses as just silly, wacky, harmless guys. But this is how corporate feminism works. Companies can't ignore the new feminism of the age because their customers expect them to keep up with the times. So you get these girls can do anything campaigns and Barbie has a butt sometimes campaign and a film about defeating the patriarchy. But behind the scenes, the company can't actually be feminist because that would be bad for business. They know exactly what's going on at their factories, but that won't stop them demanding higher production targets for lower production costs. That's just business, baby. You can't girl boss without just a little bit of labor exploitation. The day after watching the film, my co-writer Ada and I both were feeling a little down. And after a while, we started talking about what was bothering us. And we found that we were both feeling bad about our bodies. That since watching the film, we had come out feeling worse about how we look. And that actually surprised us because we both kind of thought that Barbie would leave us with some good vibes, a little bit of girl power. But it actually just reminded us of how high the standards are. Yes, Barbie tells a wrinkled old woman she's beautiful, but at the same time, you can buy official Barbie anti-wrinkle cream, have smooth skin like Barbie with official Barbie bikini serum, or you can buy some official NYX Barbie makeup. And don't forget, your teeth are ugly too. Barbie wants you to feel good about yourself, while reminding you that you will never be good enough without these products. As Jessica DeFino puts it, you cannot subvert the politics of Barbie while preserving the beauty standards of Barbie. The beauty standards are the politics. This film is about how Barbie is a victim of the same misogyny women face every day. They want us to feel that Barbie's not an it, not a successful brand, not an intellectual property, but a she, a victim, a person, a woman. She may be selling you cosmetics for smooth, firm skin, but only because she too has felt the shame of cellulite. The film is a great ad, but is it feminist? Is it really fair to call it that? Is liberation factory made? And if so, who's working in the factory? The whole system of media and culture is broken. It's built on exploitation, and Gerwig hasn't, like, taken advantage of that system to create great feminist cinema. She's just been absorbed into the system. This film could never have been anything other than what it was. I'm afraid the feminism of Barbie is an artificial and appropriated one, designed specifically to sell you products, many, many products, and nothing more. So instead of buying a ticket to see Barbie, consider supporting this channel on Patreon. That sounds like a totally fine thing to say. I don't get paid as much as Greta Gerwig. And I won't try to sell you any serums. Unless you want me to. Thank you to all of our patrons who make these videos possible. And a very special thank you to Elecante, Aaron, AJ Mango, Alexis, All Ducks Rock, Ali Kitten 87, Alfie Panpele, Alwyn Mouton, Amelia D, Andrew Cokemore, Angela, Anya Steven, Ariel Rodriguez, Artemix, Ariote, Basti Wolf, Basute, Besna Plaza, Beslaf, Beth, Byroni, Break Every Yoke, Brian Espinoza, Bruno Ruchiga, Bump Girl, Simwa, Carl, Casey Boisvert, Katrina Lexi, Charis Edwards, Chelsea S, Chloe G, Chloe Plaultz, Chloe Strange, CJ Gibson, Claire, Clemence Lavelle, Cleo McKeeva, Comfort and Adam, David, Dax, Deanna McMillan, Didruel, Devola Serin, 120416, Dorothy, Dr. Most Beautiful Duck, Eden Ladley, Eri Enby, Eleanor McDougall, Elizabeth Early, L Like the L Word, Elora Woolmisley, Elsie Astro, Emma Bales, Emery James Fairgrieve, Erica Nisland, Erica Ligren, Eve Griffith, Faye Crossroads, Fancy Angles, Fickle Harpy, Fluffy Bunny Boo, Fox E, Gabriella Day, Gavin Salmon, Gerald Brenter, Ghosts and You Might Die, Ginger, Giovanni Scaramelli, Grisa Alafarben, Guilhem Perez, Gwenda Euphoria, Hannah Burgess, Hannah Law, Hayley LeBang, Helena Barbarousis, Arius of Ulithane, Hunker Munker, Hertzville, Izzy Kostel, Jackie Queen of Thieves, Jem Krasowski, Jamie Midge, Jennifer Fronister, Jessage, Gillian D, Joe Liss, Joe McManus, Jules Inkwell, Juliana Baca, Julio Leote, Julio Mendez, Julius Sarwin, June September, Juniper Lopez, Kale, Carnelius, Kata, Katharina Glomb, Katie Bollinger, Katrina Kaufman, Kata, Katia, Kaysera, Kelatua, Kelly Flynn, Kelp, Chris P, Kyle Denley, Lee Fowler, Lewis McLeod, Lee Headstrom, Leanne Lairmore, Lindsay Mercer, Liren E, Lisa Spitalovitz, Lobster Mogster, Logan K, Lorelei McLaughlin, Lumpy Llama, Murray Bass, Marla Nolting, Marma Reed, Marim, Math Class Warfare, Malka, Maxim Shulin, McKenning Wood, Meg, Metavor, Mia Nilo, Mo, Mochiban, Mugsy, Moomin Puppet, Moshe Gordon Radian, Mrun Mai Salil, Matheta, Mirren McGlynn, Mickey, Nilo Hiren, Neve Finney, Nicholas Venturo, Nick Snary, Nina Vangberg, Non Anonymous, Nora Carlson, Nullbuild, Olioli 1234, Olivia Thiderman, Ossian Matthew, Panny Lynn, Paul Stevenson, Pseudo Pac-Man, Public L, Rachel Ratt, Rochelle, Radical Planning, Dead Davidson, Rebecca Peacock, Rhys Enghart, River Felix, River Haddock, RSS, Ruxandra Greco, Salem, Sarah Buchelman, Sarah R, Saria, Shoxtopia, Sean Haskett, Selenio Latovara, Sean, She Algorithm, Sierra Kaplan Nelson, Sierra Rhodes, Sylvia, Simon Patience, Sir Kiki, Sithvich, Soham Banerjee, Soon to be Dr. Worm, Sophie, Spencer Sign, Starry Sunset, Stephen Wallace, Summertime Killer, Susie S, T. Thomas, Talia Parkinson, Teb9893, Taylor White, The Nihilist, Theo Falling, Thistlecat, Thomas Ersing, Tiago, Tim Anderson, Tiny Wooden Tree, Tom Harrison, Troy Zaire, Valeria, Verlux, Vicious Panda, Vicky Green, Victoria Cheryponova, Vince Whittaker, Wards, Wesley Botham, Will O'Connor, Jonathan Zunga, and Zet.
Put your toes to the ground, move your body.